Bernardini, and he's talking about Terra Bruciata.
Thank you. It's not, it doesn't matter. Okay. So, did you hear the news? Some researcher at, I don't remember which university, discovered that software has bugs. They will get the Nobel for the obvious things. Seriously. I guess you are not surprised, but I think that you should be. You see, 4 years ago, Robert Dewar wrote this article that you can find in, on the network about why we shouldn't put with software glitches. In the, this article, he points out that we accept in software a quality that is usually much lower than the quality we accept with other stuff, say cars, TV, or microwave ovens. Why is that? Well, he says, and I agree with him, that the problem is mostly cultural. And it's nicely summarized in this slide. Bugs are like bad weather, annoying, but you know, a fact of life. And since they are annoying, but a fact of life, people accept them. You will not accept a car that suddenly stops in the middle of the road, but you accept a software that gives you a blue screen of death. Yes, it's annoying, but you know, there is a turnaround, and what can you do? This is usually my reaction. Okay, usually I'm not that aggressive. But more or less the idea is that. Blue guy here made two mistakes. First, the word annoying. Bugs are not annoying. They are dangerous. When I started making this presentation, I researched a while for in the net for bugs that had some serious consequences. And the situation is pretty scary. This is just an excerpt of the maybe the worst one. I guess the in my opinion, the scariest one is the first one. Terrac 25, a machine for radiotherapy. If the user acted too fast on the interface, the graphical interface, a race condition caused an excessive dose of radiation to the patient. And look at the Wikipedia entry, the entire description is pretty scary. Second one, I guess it's the third in that list, unintended acceleration. That was a bit controversial. The car maker said that the user was making a mistake, pressing the accelerator instead of the brake. Then it was the mat that stopped the accelerator, but in the end it seems that it was a memory corruption that caused the throttle of the accelerator stuck full open. Okay, I understand. As an Italian commercial says, ti piace vincere facile. That is, you like an easy win. You did some kind of cherry picking, you did. I mean, you choose a medical device, you choose a car, those are serious stuff, dangerous stuff, and an error in a car is dangerous. Okay, but what about, say, a music player? I mean, what kind of harm can you get from a bug in a music player? Okay, please enter the last, the bug in 2015. Two researchers demonstrated that it was possible to take full control remotely of a car by going through the entertainment system. The entertainment system was bugged, they hacked that, and it was connected to the bus of the car. They were able to control everything, wheel, accelerator, brakes. And the last one, it was in 2016, there was a wave of denial of service attack done via some IP cameras. The worst one, it was an attack that sent a tsunami of data of 1 terabit per second to the, don't remember the target. And so the message, especially in the two last cases, is this. Even if your device is harmless, a player, a camera, a bug there can be dangerous too, because it can trigger some more serious stuff, and it can be used as a way to attack something. That is especially important now that the Internet of Things is getting fashionable, and this explains the strange video at the beginning. How can a toothbrush bring down the power grid? Well, it's easy. You have a toothbrush connected to the internet. They exist. There is a big brand who is selling them. Don't ask why. I cannot understand why you could want your toothbrush connected to the internet, but they exist. If they had a bug, they could be enrolled for a denial of service to, say, the power grid, the stock market, or whatever. So, sorry, too fast. So, at this point, one could say, okay, you solved your point. Bugs are dangerous, are serious stuff, but you know, they are unavoidable. So they are not really like bad weather, but like more meteors. Dangerous, but you know, you hope that it never happened. And maybe you can have some kind of passive defense. Do backups or build shelters in case a meteor strikes. Actually, even the word unavoidable, okay. And the fact that this idea is changing is reflected here. This is a piece of news that about a bill that was proposed in US in order to secure the Internet of Things. So they recognize that the bugs here can be dangerous. But look what they do. They ask that the software is patchable. They are not asking for software that works. They are asking for software that can be patched, because the basic idea here is that bugs are a matter of life. And even this is not true. The usual counter example is avionics. A 787 has 7-8 million lines of code. How many lines of code flew over our head so far, and there is not a single incident that brought to a death of someone due to the software. So, yes, the usual objection is, okay, it's possible to write good software, but it's expensive, it's time consuming, and since it's time consuming, we cannot do that because we need to be fast to get to the market. Two counter objection. First, that's not an excuse. There is my life at stake, so if it's expensive, too bad, sorry for you, but you are going to write a good software. And second, it seems that it's not really so expensive as many believes. Talking with someone who works with the O178, that's the certification standard for software running on planes, I was told that if you do the things correctly, and that's a big if, that is, if you rethink your process in order to comply with that standard and do not try to do to glue the standard of your process, the increase on expenses is more or less maybe 45%, not 200 like sometimes you hear. Okay, 50% is it's not negligible, but it's not even so huge. So, okay. Software, good software can be written. It's important that it's written, but nobody does that. What are you going to do? What I'm going to do? Welcome to Terra Bruciata. Terra Bruciata is the Italian expression for scorched earth, that strategy where you burn everything so your enemy has no resources. And the idea is to burn the ground around the bugs so they have no more place to hide. More precisely, my vision, as your PHB would say, is to bring process, tools, ideas from the high integrity software context into the open source software context. It will not be easy. The high integrity stuff was born in an industrial environment. So, for example, the O178 was born in an industrial environment. And in industry, you have a hierarchy with your boss. Your boss say, starting for tomorrow, we are going to do it this way. You say, why? Because I'm the boss, and say so. If you don't do it this way, you're fired. Maybe many management books would not suggest this strategy, but it can work. In open source, of course, you cannot do this way. In open source, open source communities are run mostly by volunteers, in a distributed way, so it's a different environment. And trying to adapt something born in an industrial environment to this one, maybe it's a bit challenging, but we can try it. Why? What I think to achieve? Well, three objectives. The first one maybe is the most obvious, but not the most important, to produce better software, which, you know, is something that's a good in itself. But the second objective is to make an example and show other people that this is possible. So my idea I hope to, you know, to attract to this idea other open source communities, but also I think that it will be important, let me say this, to let know everyone that writing good software is important and possible, even without being a software house that works for Airbus or Boeing. This should be known not only to technical people like us, not only to your C-suite, but to everyone. Because what we want is a kind of market pressure. People must get enraged when the game gives the blue screen of death. And finally, an interesting side effect is that we most probably will need to develop processes, tools, and a way to use some sophisticated tools like formal checking, in a process context, and this experience, these tools, could be used by other developers, open source or not, to help producing better software. So this is not really, let's say that the main objective is the second one. The first and the third are nice side effects. So I told you about the why. Bugs are serious stuff. The what, I want people to write, the why, bugs are serious stuff, the what, I want to distribute, to promote an idea of correct software. Remember that Robert Dewar said that the problem is cultural. Here we are trying to address the root of the problem. Okay? And now let's talk a bit about the how. So, what kind of software we are going to develop? My idea was to start with something quite peculiar, that is libraries for network protocols. The little devil there was added today while I was at the ADA developer room, and I saw a talk about using ADA in little embedded environment. And that could be another interesting theme. But, you know, we start sticking with the original plan. And if you get enough people, attract enough interest, we can start also this branch. This just was added 4 years, 4 hours ago. Okay, so the idea of starting with network protocols is quite peculiar, I admit. But there is a reason. Actually, there are two or maybe three. The first reason is that networking today is very important. Another nomination to the Nobel for the obvious stuff. Actually, many people believe that programming is just web development. So we can agree that networking is very important, and it's useful to have some safe implementation of that. That's quite interesting. Actually, there is more to that. The networking part of your application is the entrance gate of your application. So, and if your gate is weak, you can build a castle as strong as you want, but the whole system will be weak. So, and moreover, what's worse, if you have a library with bugs that is used like a network protocol as a building block, This library will be used in many applications. And if there is a bug, you will have lots of bugs around. Do you remember Heartbleed? That's the same idea. So, since we need to start from somewhere, this could be an interesting, a context where we can do a very strong impact about safety. Moreover, there are another couple of reasons. There are a couple of reasons that, let's say, we try to get two birds with a stone, and that could be of could be useful also for protocol development. You know, the IETF has two tiers for protocols. One is a proposed standard, and the other one is internet standard. In order to be promoted to internet standard, they need at least two different implementations of the same protocols. Why? The idea is quite obvious. If you have two different independent implementations, the word independent is important, that talk each other, then you are quite sure that the specification of protocol are not ambiguous and complete. What happens usually is this. While the protocol is being developed, someone writes a library for that protocol, some software for that protocol. Because in IETF they believe in running code, correct. And so at least one version of the protocol is available. Starting from that, many cases, if you need another library in a different language, you don't rewrite the same library from scratch, but use the first one, usually written in C, and do a binding. And you know, if you have a Ruby binding for a C library, that's not an independent version. It's the same code with a different address. Since in our case, we are interested in developing correct software, we have a reason for rewriting the stuff. And as a nice effect, we can get an independent implementation for promoting the code to the higher tier. And moreover, IETF is trying to have some connection with academia and with open source communities. They haven't started this initiative that's called CodeStand. CodeStand is basically a way to connect, to propose some project to be implemented and keeping track of who is implementing what. This is the home page of CodeStand. As you can see, really not many bell and whistles, really to the point. And I don't know if someone of you have ever been in an IETF meeting. If you want to have an idea what an IETF meeting is, take FOSDEM and make everyone 20 years older, you get the ETF. Yes, it's a very, very special group. Still working by a mailing list, I guess they are the last ones who, sorry. They are the last one who still work and communicate via mailing list, but it works. They bring and staying at ATF meeting is something that one should go just to see the environment. It's and this, for example, is a code request, code requests. So these are open teams for someone who wants to try to develop this stuff. And we could be a nice channel between open source and ITF. Let's say this is not the most important result, but it's a nice side effect. Okay, still staying on the side of how, let's go a little bit technical. And this is something that I feel like in the need of explain, maybe defining a bit. So the idea is to develop this stuff using, if possible, Spark and ADA. By the way, Spark has nothing to do with Apache. It's a subset of ADA that's suitable for format checking. Format checking means that you have a piece of software that can check if there are no, say, no buffer overflow, there are no exception, you use everything when it's being initialized, but also you can have the program to formally prove that, say, your function actually does what it says to do. You write, say, precondition, postcondition, and the Spark can check that if the precondition is true, given the code, the function, the postcondition will be true. This can help a lot, actually, helps a lot in finding bugs. That's the idea that I have about Terra Bruciata. This is a way to burn a lot of ground. It will not burn all the ground. There will be still something that you can do in Spark, something that you need to do with testing, but this can help quite a lot. And the usual objection when I talk about ADA is that it's old. I'm not going to do an advocacy of ADA now. Usually here in Fosden there is the ADA developer room. You can go there and for more deep discussion. But basically the idea is that actually I use a lot so far. I was graduated more or less 50 years ago. And in all those years, I used, I don't know how many programming languages. And I use C, C++, and other stuff. My personal experience is that debugging with ADA is much, much faster. Let's say that one tenth of the effort. Really, if you help the compilers helping you, it can be really, really a strong help. It's not a magic bullet, of course. Usually the objection is that the real quality comes from the programmer, not from the tool. And it's true, I agree. But you know, even a chef that needs to do something complex like filleting fish prefer to use the flexible knife because the job is done faster and maybe with better quality. So even if you are a professional programmer, you have a lot of experience, you would prefer to use a better tool that helps you in the job, basically. And believe me, the other objection usually is about speed. But ADA is compiled like every other language, so more or less there is no, and actually it can be used on very small devices. A few years ago here in Fosden there was a talk that showed the Lego Mindstorm programmed in ADA in order to make an inverse pendulum, a segue. And it was a multitasking code in over the Mindstorm that is a 16-bit CPU with, I don't remember, 64 kilobits of RAM, stuff like that. So it's not only something that runs on planes. And, well, this objection, I guess, it's not... So, what time is it? Okay, a little bit early, but I guess. Okay, what is the current status of this? This is a quite a young idea. I got this idea maybe less than 1 year ago. Currently, I'm working myself with a couple of students of mine that should graduate in the next few months, so I will be left alone. And I started with trying to implement co-op. I don't know how many of you know co-op. Co-op is a lightweight HTTP. It's very in the spirit of HTTP, but it's based on UDP, not TCP. And it's all binary, while HTTP is text-based. This is all binary. This was developed for the Internet of Things, as usual. Why this? Honestly, no special reason. We need to start from somewhere. This is connected to Internet of Things, which is important nowadays at applicative level. So we started with this. We are currently trying to get from the RFC to summarize it in a few formal statements of requirements, and from that starting developing with more or less the idea that you can find in DO178. Minus all the bureaucracy that DO178 has. And so the idea here is to try to collect at least initially a condensation core of people that can be really interested in the idea of writing correct code. So if you want to get in touch with me, here there are my email address, my LinkedIn page, there is also a LinkedIn group, and there is also a page on SourceForge, but I forgot to put the link here, but I guess you will be able to find it. And I hope here there is someone interested in this stuff. So it's something that's starting. So it's open to new directions. So it's open to commenters. It's open maybe the idea of using or writing network protocols maybe can change. I don't know. If there is enough convincing arguments, maybe it can change. Maybe we can start also different branch, for example, in embedded or other stuff. And that's it. I am open to questions if you have any. I guess I'm a little bit early, but I think you will not cry.
Thank you very much, first. And here's the first question.
Yeah, hi, so I'm Yannick Moy, project leader for Spark at Decor. So I have one question and two comments. So my question is, how did you make your slide? And my first comment is about what you said or what somebody told you about building Avionics software that costs only 50% more than regular software. Just to dismiss any misconception, that's not true at all. So NASA documents some years ago counted something like 7 times more investment in verification phase with respect to development for this kind of software And even last week, I was at the avionics conference, and Airbus presented the big project to reduce the costs in DO178. And they were saying that for their typical product, verification was 70% compared to development 30%. And I could go on about all the development assurance that you need. It's much more than just 50%. Just so that you know,
okay.
High critical software really requires much, much more. So you cannot just copy paste such processes. But it's nonetheless, my last comment is obviously we are very supportive of a project. We use the kind of technology that are used in avionics and other domains. Just wanted to say that even though Terra Bruciata seems like a good idea, these kind of initiatives in individual projects have been going on for many years already. And for example, I encourage you to look at Muen. Muen is a separation kernel written in Spark. Was led by this person next to me when he was at CQNet. And is separation kernel is something quite big, where you ensure security of applications by having a kernel that ensures subjects do not interact in a non-authorized way. And this kernel is a small kernel in Spark that has improved absence of runtime errors, so there's no possible attacks of many different kinds. So just to say, it's a great project, but be aware that there are many others open source projects with these technologies.
Yeah. Okay.
There was one question.
Well, okay, thank you. The figure about that, I found that the 50% I found in a book, I don't remember the title was about, I'm not, so just to be clear, I'm not an expert, I'm studying this stuff right now for this reason, but about the other initiatives, actually I was in the other developer room when you talked about them, and I was happy to hear that I'm not alone. let's say that maybe this also has a different flavor. The other initiative was, let's produce a separation kernel. I don't remember the other stuff. Here the idea is let's do this also for a public relation stuff. So they producing good software is also to say to the world, look, good software can be done. To try to
so, definitely a good idea. Just to say, there are other things that you could look at or others could look at. For example, in terms of examples, Tokenier example was produced by Altran in Spark for the NSA in 2005. We open sourced it in 2008. Everything is on the web. So,
By the way,
there are others to look at for inspiration in that case for as examples.
By the way, I will look also today. I discovered about those projects you talked about, and I plan to look into them, to, for example, to see for idea processes and how they did that in order to import in this context. So, actually, I repeat, I'm happy that I'm not alone in this.
So, I feel a bit skeptical about the idea that if you demonstrate that you can build correct software, then other projects will start adopting the same methodologies. One reason is that, as was pointed out, there already exists software that was developed to be verified from the start, and yet the methodologies are not common in the open source community, for example. And sometimes I think maybe it's because the tools that have been used in the Spark ADA community or the people that do stuff with proof assistants and so on, are very different from the tools that are used in existing projects. And maybe what we also should do is start trying to adopt tools for formal verification in important open source projects of today. I was wondering if you had an opinion on that, because I worry, so you would build a protocol implementation in Spark ADA. But then people could say, yeah, it works because it's Spark ADA, but we are, I don't know, a Java shop, or we use C right now, so we cannot use this methodology.
Okay, so first about the what you said at the beginning. You see, those projects, I discovered about those projects today, and they have an interest in correct software, I develop in ADA, and stuff like that. So maybe what's missing is, I know that maybe in this context I'm going to say a bad word, but kind of marketing stuff. So letting people to know that to actually try to spread this idea, not just, because for example, those are projects I discovered today, and I have an interest in this. So.
So just to answer it, because I think there's an answer. This domain, these tools for more verification, higher critical software, it's very open source rich. You have plenty of tools that are open source, and particular industrial tools. So for example, if you do C code, there's Framasy. Framasy is a well-known tool. It's not adopted very widely because all these incur a cost. So if you, I mean, for our software, for building our own software in ADA, we don't use our sales part because it would be too costly. We'd have too many constraints to develop a tool that is not as critical as that. And so just to mention, for C, we'd have from a C that implements the same thing with the underlying same building blocks, in fact, from also the open source community, so open source provers. For Java, you have OpenGML, which is also open source. So you have framework tools like that are available for a few languages. I believe that for C code, for the drivers, people have used CLI, for example, model checking of C code. So I don't know the state exactly of that, but yeah, for Microsoft, there was SLAM. And well, I guess there are many, many tools, and it depends on the motivation of communities. Higher critical software may require more effort. So again, it depends on the motivation of the community.
Hi, I like the initiative to make a more secure infrastructure. On the other hand, I just did a project on an X-ray machine, and I think 60 to 70% of our product code was test code. So I think the current test infrastructures, if you expand them and they get attention, we would already get there. And another lots of problems is indeed the legacy of C and C++ that hurt us. So ADA could be a solution, or Rust, or I don't know what other initiatives that there are. So I wish you all the luck with this initiative, and I hope more do follow.
Hello. I was wondering, and I don't know if you can give us some figures, if, for example, I'm thinking about the Linux kernel. There is a lot of critical open source software that is used heavily in production nowadays, and I find it difficult to believe that some kind of formal verification technique was not already applied on the large scale on this kind of software. Do you have some idea about what was done already
at the industrial level, I don't know, but you know, doing formal verification on languages like C, maybe I'm not an expert in this field, so but I think that it could be much more difficult than using other tools, because C is, I mean, if you want to do formal verification, you cannot use pointers. And if you write a C without pointers, you do not do much. Having just passing parameters for that must be written from by a function, you cannot do it. Instead in ADA, many of the those usual pointers are hidden by the language. So, for example, you say that this parameter is an out parameter. Of course, the compiler will pass a pointer, but it remains hidden. And so it, you can avoid using pointers. But a disclaimer, I'm not an expert in this field, so maybe...
Just I would like to maybe give an expert view on this one.
Thank you.
pointers can be used in formal verification. The more pointers you have, the less it's easy to do. And for example, VCC is a tool that was produced by Microsoft Research, now is used at Amazon to formally verify C code. Framasy is an open source tooling that is used to formally verify C code in industrial context. So just OpenGmail obviously is used to verify Java. So yeah, you can. And just to answer, because there was a question before on languages matter a lot for these kind of things. Last week, Xavier Leroy, the creator of OCaml and CompCert certified compiler, gave a presentation on that. And yeah, he started, although he created this compiler from C to assembly, he started by saying that C is ugly. Yes, C is ugly, and you cannot really work around it. This morning, or the person doing the presentation on software quality in Mozilla, just urged people to move away from C++ to Rust. Xavier Roy would go to OCaml instead. I would go to Spark. Just know that there are other alternatives than C and C++, and that the language matters if you want to go to that level.
I was going to ask if it's kind of a project founded by a university. It's frankly, I feel really sad to see such things occupying space in universities as a like for future generations.
Well, so far there is no funding. More or less, it's me working on following students who are graduating. And the amount of resources are not huge. And by the way, I believe that it's something that can be useful. Can be important for the future. I mean, having this, promoting this idea, and also teaching students that software can and must be good because it's important, and teaching them skills about how to write good software, I mean, I believe that's really important. And
so thank you very much, Riccardo.
Welcome.